Thank you so very much for this very kind introduction. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm very happy to be here. It's an honor to speak here. And actually, it's not too far away, as you've heard from other members of European Parliament who already have been addressing you, I guess, in the last 2 days. We're just a few hundred meters away. We don't even have to leave the building between the old premises of the European Parliament and the current ones. I chose that topic because I would like to maybe provoke some thoughts and controversy also in this distinguished audience, because why would female parliamentarians be crucial for women's rights? Why can't men and women, when they're in parliament, take care of that important issue? And why would female parliamentarians focus specifically on women's rights and not on human rights? So why do we need this gender distinction? Aren't we just one society where we should all care about each equally, no matter which gender and which race, which religion, which part of the world we come from? Well, looking at the fact, female parliamentarians are quite a new phenomenon. 120 years ago, it was the first time ever that women got the right to vote, so much, much later than men. And it was even less than 120 years ago that the first female parliamentarians began entering parliaments, always in very, very small minorities. And still today, according to the Interparliamentary Union, only 20% of the global community of parliamentarians are women, which are about 9,000 women in the various parliaments. Obviously, this has big regional differences. Some countries are very close to a more gender-balanced leadership. Others are very far away from it and have just a few, let me call them token women in the parliament, sometimes not even elected, but appointed to sit there to just also be able to say we do also take women's views into consideration. So, four arguments why I think women in parliament, even today, 2014, is an issue that needs to be addressed. Well, first of all, if you consider parliaments as the representation of the people, then it's a numbers game. More than half of the population of the world are women. 20% of the representatives are women. There is an obvious mismatch. This is just numbers. Second argument, leadership. We've seen certain styles of leadership being very established and being, in a way, the prototype of how leaders behave, how leaders decide, how leaders act. And we've seen in many, many different practical observations and also theoretical studies that leadership styles differ. And if you combine different styles of leadership, then you get to better results. So gender plays a role in how to lead and how leadership is perceived. Third argument, and this might cause some controversy, I think women in parliaments guarantee better legislation. That the shift on the agenda of what's important and what's less important, where is public money attributed to, what kind of society do we want to live in, changes significantly with the number of women being represented in a parliament. And fourth argument, women's rights are obviously human's rights. Human rights. I mean, there is, I always find it, like in my home country, where we've got a ministry in charge of women's, youth, and senior citizens' issues. I always think it would be so much easier to call it ministry for men, because every other part of society is kind of singled out. And I just think this shows that there is still this perception mismatch, and human rights should be the focus and not having those differences. Now, let me talk about three different points shortly. One is, what's the significance, the specific one, of women in parliaments, of female parliamentarians? Well, parliamentarians are visible societal leaders. They have to present themselves to their voters, they have to be in permanent contact with various stakeholders, so they are quite visible. And obviously, politics is about having role models. And we need different kind of role models. We have the whole variety of men, let's say, in the parliament, young, older, with children, without children, different educational backgrounds. This truly is a representation of, so to say, a part of society. For female leaders, that is still missing. If you close your eyes for a moment and think of leader, it's quite unlikely that, let's say, a woman beginning 30s would come to your mind. You would have more likely a more senior gentleman in front of your inner eye, you would consider him as being the leader. And if you just look at Europe today, there is a big change. We have obviously Angela Merkel, who is one kind of female leader. We have then, for example, the Danish Prime Minister, who is a very different kind of female political leader. And we see in governments like the French government or the current Italian government, all kinds of different personalities, which give the opportunity for girls and for boys to see different leadership roles, different leadership personalities, and not just one prototype to which you unconsciously or consciously compare yourself and ask yourself, could I be there when I'm grown up or not? And in the case of my oldest daughter, who is 10 years old, the others are a bit younger, she once asked me, in Germany, actually, can there a man also be chancellor? Because in her 10 years, she only always saw Merkel, and I thought that was a quite cute question. Now, women as societal leaders are important because as a parliamentarian, you're commissioned, you have the mandate to take decisions on behalf of your voters. So you have to take decisions for the whole of society. And this means that you have to accept that women are in charge. And this is important because in many countries you can still find a reluctance to accept, for example, female judges or female leaders in other parts, like chief editors or economic leaders. And so those visible societal leaders in parliament can result in having these different perceptions of women as leaders in general, which then advances society to a different form of decision making. And in the words of Michelle Bachelet, the now second time president of Chile and former head of UN Women, she said, if one woman is a leader, it changes her. If many women are leaders, it changes society. And this brings me to my second point, the better legislation that we could see if there are more women. Now, Hillary Clinton said, never waste a crisis. And you can see that in many countries who are emerging from crisis, that just for the mere fact of having no alternative, they give women more opportunities. Men are dead, or men are commissioned of or found guilty of crimes, so not suitable for leadership positions, as many as they would have been before. You've got some very, very obvious examples. For example, Germany after the Second World War, there was that famous Trümmerfrauen, those women who you can see on pictures, because of the absence of men, building up houses, running businesses. Politically, it took a bit longer, but also in countries like Rwanda, where this year is the 20 years commemoration of the Tutsi genocide, where after the genocide, 70% of the population were women. Only 30% men were left because of what happened during the genocide. And of those, also not all of them would have been suitable to be then sitting together in a meeting room and finding solutions for the whole of society. So one of the main factors in rebuilding society there was empowering women. But even today, here in Europe, yesterday's vote, for example, the European Parliament on the new banking union rules in Europe were brought forward by women. It was five female parliamentarians and one male from the Green Group, which usually is the more women-focused group, were the authors of that legislation. And some argue if it would have been Lehman Sisters and not Lehman Brothers, we wouldn't have been in the mess anyways. But just a very few highlights, economic empowerment. The IMF argues would be 27% of GDP growth globally if women would get full economic empowerment, meaning they can inherit, they have the right to ownership, and many basic factors which would allow women to be participating in the market. And usually those kind of legislations are sponsored mainly by female parliamentarians, not because men would try to avoid it, but very often it's just not part of their priority agenda. Secondly, the general economic environment improves if you have more women in parliaments. Corruption goes down, you have more transparency, and social legislation is improved. Again, this has to do with a more gender-balanced decision-making. Education. Education ranks much higher on the agenda because traditionally, education for women means the possibility to decide herself on her life and have freedom for choosing what she would like to do and also when she would like to have children. So education usually gets much higher priority on a national political agenda. Health, again, also traditionally for women, important issue, as they tend to be responsible for family health. And prevention becomes a more important factor because if you, as a mother, know how much it blocks you in doing anything if you have a sick child at home, the important shifts are there. And you can see that, for example, in healthcare models and others. Finally, the mother of all issues is the integrity of the person. And also there, UN Women data shows clearly that due to more female parliamentarians or due to more female political leaders, issues of domestic violence, of sexual violence, but also conflict and post-conflict management and the role of women in it gets much higher recognition and also becomes an issue on the agenda. And again, this is due to mainly a growing caucus of female parliamentarians. Now, how do we get more women in parliament? Well, UN Women set up a very fantastic tool, which is a constitutional database, where they compare all the constitutions of all countries worldwide and give recommendation of how to change or improve constitutions in order to have more gender equality. And Tunisia, when it just voted on its new constitution, took these recommendations very much into account and is very much proud of this. Looking at facts and figures of how the situation of countries improve with more women, look at successful countries like, for example, Iceland, where coming out of a severe crisis, now you have 4% unemployment only, which is full employment. You've got impressive economic growth again, and you have the highest standard of gender equality worldwide, similar to other Scandinavian countries. And just finally, what do I believe? Do you believe that female parliamentarians are the better parliamentarians? Well, certainly not. I mean, women have to get the chance to get corrupt or also to do bad legislation, to be involved in all kinds of flaws and scandals. It's not that they are on the morally better side of life. Well, not at all. You've got all kinds of women and all kinds of men. And Rebecca Greenspan, who used to be number two in UNDP and also was deputy prime minister in Costa Rica, she said for her, gender equality has been achieved when there are as many incompetent women in parliament as there are men. Now, I would like to see the opposite, that we've got through increased competition, more competence on both gender sides. But let me just finish by saying all those factors that I listed. Obviously, you can argue, is it because of women or is it because of a modern society that women have better possibilities to advance? And I think it's a give and take in the end. If you have a society where you have equal opportunities for everybody, then you tend to have an independent judiciary. You tend to have more modern institutions. You tend to have independent and free media. You tend to have all these factors that you need to have a modern society. And then women obviously have better opportunities to thrive and become leaders. And this, again, I think makes it beneficial for all of us and for society as a whole. So with this, I think I'll close my short intervention and look forward to maybe, I don't know what the time is, a few questions or discussions. Thank you.